What's up, guys? How's it going? And welcome to the Minute Channel. Today we have a discussion video pertaining to localization and translations and the difference between the two things. I'll make this more pertaining to persona and everything, but this is really something that goes through a lot of different stuff. So in case you guys didn't know, I'm a bilingual. In fact, I have actually done a lot of translation work legally and professionally for like the last like 5 or 6 years. I've done this for a living, basically. So I know my fair share of translation. On the other hand, there is a difference between translating something and a localization, which is a completely different term. And it means a completely different thing in a different aspect. So anyway, let's go ahead and jump into the video. Let's talk about the two differences between these two different things and why fan translations aren't as cut dry as a lot of people make them out to be. So honestly, there is a huge difference pertaining to how localizations and translations were done back in the 80s and the 90s, even in the early 2000s. And although nowadays there is a big talk pertaining to things like how people see censorship and localizations in a really negative light, I still think that a lot of localizations do a really good job as far as like bringing the material to another country. So what is a localization, first of all? So localization is basically a job that gets translated into another language, but more than anything, it gets basically it changes. It's a medium that it brings a media, which is whether it's a movie or a TV show or a game, and it brings it into another country, another culture, and it really, what it does, it tries to make it more more fitting for the particular culture. Now, a lot of people see this in a really bad light, as I mentioned before, because some localizations have done terribly. For example, in Persona 1, Persona 1 Revelations on PlayStation 1 in the US, there were some really outrageous changes. For example, they changed the way that the characters look, particularly the main protagonist and one of the other protagonists, characters in the game, Mark, which they really changed the race of the character. They changed the way that he looked and everything. It's really outrageous if you look at it that way. On the other hand, they even changed the names, they changed a lot of the aspects, they cut a lot of content, and to an extent, a lot of people see this as a really bad localization. It really just, not, I wouldn't necessarily say ruined the game, but it really changed what the author was trying to go for in this game. It really just modified a property into something completely different. Nowadays, nobody really likes the unless people are like playing it for the memes or maybe for like historical purposes, nobody is really actively looking for Persona 1 Revelations on PlayStation 1 American Edition and trying to play that version. It just doesn't really happen nowadays. So what is the difference between something like that and localizations nowadays? So now, in the early days, in the 80s and the 90s, there were a lot of big changes when it came to localization. And the reason for that being is, one, there was a big emphasis on Americans or American audiences thinking of anime the same way as they see American cartoons, which is for kids. Like, legitimately, a lot of these people that were doing the localizations and the themes, not only those, but also people like the ESRB or other government agencies were looking at anime at the same light as they see American cartoons. So this is a big deal, because if you played any of the Persona games or a lot of the Japanese games or any anime, you know that anime is not necessarily for kids. In fact, a lot of it is intended for mature or teenager audiences. It's not necessarily for kids. So what leaves the localization having to modify that particular piece of media to fit what the new intended audience is, which is children. So that's something that obviously has changed over time. I think a lot of people know more about anime localizations, understand more about the property coming from the anime. ESRB has changed more over time, has evolved, if you will, and it really has become more commonly accepted to see more anime games change into more like mature or teen rating, because it really does see the different lights. So that's localization in a nutshell. So what about translation and fan translation? So one thing that I've seen a lot of people complain about is the way that localization look at certain translations. There's a lot of translation things that they either change the intention of a sentence, or they change the way the structure is made. They'll add like some references to something else, some like Western influences and that kind of stuff. So why does that happen? So that happens because a localization is, for all intents and purposes, trying to change a media to a particular culture, as I mentioned before. To a lot of people, that it isn't a legitimate translation, and it's not trying to be a legitimate translation. It's trying to be adapted to another country, and I think that to a majority, this is not really gonna matter too much. It's actually kind of cool to see, oh, you know, that's really funny that they did this reference to an American TV show, or you know, things like that. But it really leaves you wonder, what was the original intention? What was the original reference? What was the original meme that they referenced? You know, like, there's a lot of different things that if you've been in the industry, if you've been playing games, if you've been watching anime, you're kind of thinking like, well, what was the original thing? Like, sometimes, you know, like right now there's a lot of reference to things like Among Us or Fortnite and that kind of stuff. You're like, well, that's cool, because you know, like, a lot of the intention being is they're trying to make reference to things that kids in the West will know or understand, you know, opposed to making reference to some obscure Japanese TV show, anime, or video game that maybe a lot of people wouldn't know in the West. And that's why a lot of these things changes. Now, translations, in a sense, it's a little bit different. Now, like I mentioned before at the beginning, I've been a translator, I've been doing that job for a long time, and I've done it professionally in a setting. And to be frank with you, translating is not an easy job in like any means. Sure, you may be bilingual, you be maybe born with growing up being able to speak two languages and everything. So, but the thing is, a lot of the times when you're translating things, there are a lot of phrases, a lot of ways to say things that if you straight up translate them, they either sound nonsensical, they sound rude, they sound like they sound like it doesn't really apply to a particular conversation that is going on. And I know sometimes it's really easy to look at a screenshot of something, and then somebody's like, oh, somebody fan translated a particular point, and they're like, oh, you know, look, the fan translation is so much better. Yeah, but a fan translation is only doing one sentence. They are not translating the entire 60 hour, 50 hour, 100 hour game. You know, there's context within what you're looking at, and I think a lot of people really miss the point on that. And as somebody that has been doing it for a long time, context is really important. Sure, sometimes people look at something, they're like, oh, I just want the original intention. The problem is, again, the original intention sometimes is very nonsensical on the grand scheme of things. You can look at a screenshot, but the screenshot only tells you that particular stuff. You don't have any context to that particular translation. And I've seen a lot of where people just like, oh, the fan translation is better. How? You're just looking at a screenshot. They didn't translate 60 hours of a game. And I'll be honest with you guys, I played a lot of translation, fan translation games. For example, I played Persona 2 Innocent Sin. I played a fan translation for it, and then I played the original translation for it. I played other translations for this stuff. Some of them are good, but some of them are just not good, because some of them lack finesse. You know, some of them are missing like actual because it's a fan translation. Sometimes there's things like grammar mistakes, or even just it doesn't sound very professional. Like there's a specific aspect that makes it not look as well. And there's nothing wrong with fan translations. In fact, I loved fan translations. I worked on fan translations before, particularly for anime and manga back in my day when I started into anime and everything like that. I was translating a lot of stuff to Spanish you know, or from English to Spanish to kind of get more people into reading manga, that kind of stuff. So I have helped quite a bit with fan translations. So on that aspect, I also support fan translations. I think it's great. And I think when there's no official translation, fan translation is always the way to go. You know, there's no other way to go about it. But localizations do something, and they do it for a reason. And although I know a lot of people find it almost like offensive, or they don't like the way the translation looks or something like that, at the end of the day, keep in mind that these are also people. And, you know, like virtual signaling on the side or whatever, a lot of the times really their job is to bring a property, not translating it but localizing it. And again, like I mentioned before, it's just more adapting it for a particular audience that they are trying to go after. It's I know it's difficult to kind of grasp around it. The translation, again, it's not always, it doesn't really work one-to-one. A really easy specific example that I'm always going to remember is, I remember really growing up, I had a friend who was learning Spanish, and he knew gracias, and he knew other words in English and Spanish and everything, and we're just talking, and it's just like, hey, I say thank you, you know, I said gracias, I tell to him, and he comes back to me and he says, for nothing. Now, for nothing in Spanish is de nada, which means you're welcome. But when you translate it, for nothing almost sounds like rude in English. Like, I'm telling you thank you, but you're telling me for nothing. Like this, like, you know, it almost sounds like you're insulting them back for like, oh, you really didn't do anything for me, so, or I didn't do anything for you. So it sounds like almost a little insulting. And again, that's like a really very example, but I always keep that in my mind when somebody's like, well, translations, I'm like, yeah, but translations don't always work one-to-one. Sometimes some translations, some particular moments, sound almost rude in another language, and you don't really think to like utilize it that way. So it's not as cut dry and easy as just thinking, oh, you know, it's apples and oranges, really, that's what it is. So anyway, thank you so much for watching this video here, just discussing and talking about translations and localizations and kind of my thoughts and feelings about this. I've been holding on to this video for a minute now, but I really thought that it was a good idea to talk about this. But let me know in the comments down below, how do you guys think about this? What do you feel about translation localizations? Again, I know there's some localizations that are outrageous, they're terrible, they just don't do a good job. At the same time, I can also see it from a translating standpoint, why sometimes the things need to be changed, because there's always some logic behind it where they have to do some kind of changes. So anyway, thank you so much for watching this, guys. Like and subscribe. I'll see you guys in the next video. Bye-bye.